Welcome to Prescott Valley Bible Church this morning. Glad you could make it. Glad you all got through the rain today. Oh, it's really quiet. Let's try that again. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
All right. Glad you all could make it today.
Oh, part here.
Uh-oh. We're having a camera problem. We're jittery. Feel like I got the jitters. Bill, can you bring the music up just a little bit, please?
And I without you. I'm desperate for you. All my hands within you.
Just a few announcements. If you had a cell phone, turn it off. Don't want to interrupt the service. Don't forget the camera's going. If you got to go by, just go on by. Don't forget men's Bible study this Thursday at my house. So if you need any address or anything, well, just let me know. The sign-up sheet is back there for the mixed Bible study. That's husband and wives, or singles, and we'll be going through the Gospels. Let's see. Well, we're here to remember why we're here. We're here because of Jesus. Jesus gave his all for us, so we should do the same. We should celebrate every day and go out and, you know, the Lord wants us to spread the word. We have to pray for boldness. But Jesus died to give us that opportunity. Remember that he said, take this in remembrance of me. Remember the juice is his blood, the bread is his body. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for allowing us to partake of this. We want to thank you for giving us your Son. And we ask these things in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. To give back to the Lord. Lord loves a happy giver. You know, when you give, you're not giving to the church, you're giving to God. And every time you give, it's written in up in heaven, and it is accounted to your account. You know, you give out of your heart. Whatever your heart tells you to give, that's what you do. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for allowing us to give back to you some of the many miracles that you've given to us. And all of God's children said, Amen.
the bread and drink the wine. Come sup with me.
Well, good morning. Welcome to Prescott Valley Bible Church. I'm glad you're with us today. Hey, before we get started, I'd like to talk specifically to those people who are watching from Kentucky. There's a family there called the John David family, and you probably have seen it on the news. If not, you probably are seeing it now. But here's a family that their home burned down to nothing, and they've lost everything. They didn't lose their family. And so I see that happening, and I hear about that, and I think, well, here's a person that obviously knows the Lord, because they said it could have been worse. It could have been everybody. It could have been everything. And unfortunately, they lost everything in a house fire. And by the time they were able to get things fixed there, the house was gone. So for those of you in that area, if you can help, I want to encourage you to get a hold of your stations and figure out how you can be a part of that. People, Christ followers from all over the country have already been reaching out to these people and have been they're just being so blessed by it. And so you do the same, okay, wherever it is you're at. Open your Bibles to Mark chapter 14. Mark chapter 14. We are in part 3 of this series titled A Heart for the House. Every week, as you notice, this morning we came together, we sang worships to the Lord, sang our praises to God. And then after that, Ron led us in the time of communion, and we do that every single week, and we do that for a reason, because we're remembering the sacrifice that Jesus made for each one of us. He sacrificed for us to have life. Today's message is a little bit different than the other ones in the series. And so it might be shorter than the other ones. It may not be, so don't get too excited. We'll see how it goes. Some of you might remember me telling you a story about when I went to my late wife and I asked her to marry me. I don't know if you guys remember that story. Some of you might not have heard it, so if you heard it before, just act like it's the first time, okay? Act surprised. So anyway, I went over to this apartment. Here I am. I'm 23 years old at the time, 23 years old. And I was just graduating from school, and I was a personal trainer. I was hot. Let's just say that. Myrna probably remembers that, but I was really hot at the time. Oh, that's right. You're in. Yeah. Okay. So I go over to Shirley's place, and she's in the kitchen, and she's baking chocolate chip cookies. I knew I wanted to marry her then, for sure. But she was baking chocolate chip cookies, and here I am in this little bitty dining room off of this little galley kitchen that we had there, and I'm kneeling, you know, like they do in the movies. I won't do it now because I won't be able to get back up. But I was kneeling at the time, and I said, "Honey, will you marry me?" And she looked at me, and she says, "The cookies are done. I have to go in the kitchen." And she ran into the kitchen. And I'm here on one knee in the other room. And I'm looking, and I'm like, okay, if she doesn't come back, I've got a problem. Or if she comes back and says, "How do you like the weather?" You know, or something, change the subject. I knew I was in trouble. But she came back, and she grabbed me and kissed me. And I thought, that must be a yes. I'm thinking that's a yes. And then she said, "Yes, I'll marry you." And I thought, what an appropriate response. I'm thinking about this today. Because I'm thinking about there's appropriate responses and then there's inappropriate responses. And we're talking about today the love and the sacrifice Jesus made for each one of us. And the question becomes, what's your response? Is it an appropriate response or is it an inappropriate response? Today in our message, we're going to talk about what does God do in our lives? What has he done? And how are you and I, as Christ followers, as people who have a heart for the house being God's people and God, because we said in our first few messages that the house is not the church building that we worship in, it's you and I. It's the relationship you and I have with Jesus and with each other. And it's the love that we show. And so today we're talking about how are you and I supposed to respond to Jesus, to God, who sacrificed for us. I seem to remember reading somewhere that he was for us even before we were born. When we were yet sinners, God loved us. That's love. That's love. So, and I'm thinking about that, and I'm writing my notes down, and then I started doing these bullet points that I like to do for myself. And I said, well, let me think about this for a minute. So that means that those times in my life when I'm jerky, and you're jerky, because you're all jerky sometimes, I'm jerky sometimes, God loves us anyway. Even in those jerky moments in our lives. That even when we find ourselves walking in love unconditionally, you know, if you love me first, I'll love you. God still loves us first. You know, I think about that and I wonder, what's the appropriate response? How are you and I supposed to respond to the kind of love that Jesus has for us? Today, in Mark chapter 14, we're going to look at this story about a lady, and I'm going to give you a little background on her. I'm going to tell you something that you might not really know about her. But it's quite interesting because this is the example of appropriate response to Jesus. And we see it, and you know what's interesting about it? Not everybody is excited about it. Not everybody thinks it's an appropriate response. Not everybody feels like she did the right thing. You'll be interested to hear this story. Before we jump into it, let's take a moment and pray together. Well, dear Lord, as we come to you right now, it's our prayer, Lord, that you would guide our hearts today, that you would help us, Lord, to understand your word, that you would speak to our hearts individually, and show us what we need to know in our lives concerning this scripture, concerning this message today. Father, help us to be the people you're calling us to be. As we learn about sacrifice today, help us to understand what true sacrifice looks like. Lord, it's our will to walk in your way in everything that we do. So be with us now. Speak to our hearts. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. So we're going to go over to Mark chapter 14, verses 3 through 9, but let me set this up for you first. The story takes place just before Passover. This happened just before that, just before Jesus would ride in to town on the donkey, before the palm branches are waving, before the Last Supper. Before all of those things are happening, before Jesus goes to the cross on Calvary, before any of this happens, something happens. Jesus is at dinner with a group of religious leaders, people in that time. Mark 14, verses 3 through 9. While he was in Bethany, reclining at the table in the home of Simon the leper, let's stop there just for a minute. We'll continue with that. But Simon the leper. How would you like to have that as a nickname? Now, here's what we know. Simon the leper was not a leper anymore. Well, there wouldn't be a party at his house that anybody would go to. You and I would not go to Simon the leper's house. But here's the deal. Simon the leper was known as Simon the leper. He should have been known as Simon the no longer leper. And so sometimes, you know what happens? Sometimes you and I, we walk around with a label on that's not us anymore. We don't wear that anymore. We don't need to be called that anymore. He shouldn't have been called Simon the leper. He should have been called Simon the blessed. Simon the miracle. Simon the one who loves God. But he's not. He's known as Simon the leper. And listen, in a way, before I knew Jesus, I was Andy the leper. Not the leprosy guy, but I had my own issues. Maybe you did too. But I don't want to be known as Andy the old guy. I want to be known as Andy the new guy. The guy who walks with God. The one who wants God to lead him every step he takes. That's what you and I need to understand. And we need to walk that way. Let's continue with our sermon here, our message. 14:3-9. A woman came with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume made of pure nard. She broke the jar and poured the perfume on his head. Some of those present were saying, indignantly, to one another, why this waste of perfume? It could have been sold for more than a year's wages and more given to the poor and money given to the poor. And they rebuked her harshly. What do you think Jesus said about that? Verse 6. Leave her alone, he said. He says, why are you bothering her? She has done a beautiful thing to me. The poor you will always have with you. And you can help them anytime you want. But you will not always have me. She did what she could. She did what she could. She poured perfume on my body beforehand to prepare me for my burial. Can you imagine what that sounded like if you didn't know this was all happening? This was all before Jesus went to the cross. Verse 9. Truly I tell you, whenever the gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her. Hey, I hate to tell you this, or I like to tell you this. We're talking about it right now. We're doing it in memory of her and what she did and what she did for God, because the appropriate response to God in our lives is the same response this woman has. Now, you know what a lot of people say? We don't know who the woman is. We don't know who that woman is. I know who it is. I'm going to show you who it is in a minute. Are you suspenseful? She did what's right. She did what's right in the story. Jesus is telling the story. And we're seeing this happening. And she poured out a year's worth of wages. Just poured it out on him. Here's what you should know about this anointing oil, this oil that she poured out on him. Here's what happened back then. This was like her dowry. You ever hear of something called a dowry? This was something that was given to the husband when he married her, and it was everything she had. I mean, it was what she had saved. It was, you know, it was a lot. It was a year's worth of wages. And what did she do? She gave it fully to Jesus. She didn't think about who would want to be with me without anything. She didn't think about any of that. See, Bible scholars will tell you that oil that she poured out was like an insurance policy that she was going to have a husband someday. And she poured it out. She gave it all to Jesus. When she broke it and poured it over Jesus, she was literally pouring out her future on God. She was saying, Lord, I'm giving it all to you. I'm pouring it out on you. I hear these stories and I think, my goodness, I hear the story about this family that we just talked about, and I think about how devastating that would be. Your clothes are gone. Everything that you own is gone. I didn't say this, I'll say it right now. A few of their animals that they loved were gone. And their response to that was, those things can be replaced. We're blessed to be alive. I think about that and I go, man, how powerful that is. So her future, this lady, her future, her hopes, her dreams, she took that and said, I'm going to put this all on Jesus and let him handle this. The story starts off by these people that were standing around there criticizing her. They were talking against her. You know, can I tell you something? I don't know if I have it written down in my message or not, but I'll tell you this. When you start pouring yourself out on Jesus, it's going to be met with criticism. People are going to criticize what you do. You mean to tell me, guys, look, it's raining out today. A few weeks ago, it was snowing out, and you went to church on Sunday? You only have 2 weeks. If those of you who are working, you only have two days a week to just take it easy, to relax, to chill out, and you spend one day of it at church. What's wrong with you? What are you thinking? So let me ask you something, folks. How much does the church pay you to come down there on Sunday? No, we don't get paid. We give. You give? Wait a minute. It's Sunday. You get up in the morning, early in the morning, and you go down to church, and then you give them money? Church doesn't need your money. Church has so much money. They don't need your money. And then you tell them, well, I'm not giving my money to church. I'm giving it to God. Wow. Really? See, friends, here's what you should know. When you start pouring yourself out, and many of you know this story already because that's how you live and that's what you do, and praise the Lord for you. But the reality is you're going to be met with opposition when people hear that you're all in for Jesus, that you are not just a dabbler in Christ, you are a Christ follower, that your job as a Christian is, you know, we're called to be like Jesus. Jesus sacrificed his life for us. We need to be people who sacrifice our lives for others. Amen? Okay. Well, you know, the only thing is sacrifice sometimes doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense to us. I mean, what is this sacrifice really all about? What does it mean? And the more you start explaining about this Jesus thing, about being a Christ follower, and the more you start talking about it and about the sacrifices you make, what happens is people don't quite get it. They don't. You mean to tell me that you're supposed to forgive those who persecute you? Really? Can you do that? I'll tell you the answer to that. I can't do it on my own. I can only do it with Jesus. Because on my own, I'm just not wanting to do that. It's not built into me. And you have to ask God for help every day. Well, how often am I supposed to help other people and reach out to other people and be there for other people? And the answer is, well, according to Jesus, it's like all the time. It's like all the time. It's like we're supposed to be there all the time. Well, who am I supposed to really forgive? The people that are really close to me, that I love, that just mess up, what am I supposed to do? Because I think I could forgive my brother or my sister or my cousin or whatever it would be, whoever it would be. But who am I supposed to really forgive? Everybody. You people are crazy. You people are sacrificing your... How do you even do that? You see, today I'm talking about this thing about the church, about loving the church. And I just want to keep... I will keep saying this for the rest of the series. I'm not talking about a building. I'm not talking about loving a building, loving the pastor. I'm not talking about loving the way things run. Things are not always perfect. Believe me, I know, you know, we all know. What I'm talking about is loving God with all of our hearts and loving each other the same way. Because that's what God is calling you and I to do. Look at what it says now. Did I read to you Mark 14, 7 through 9? Let me read this in the Message Bible, how this says it. Here's what it says. But Jesus said, "Let her alone. Why are you giving her a hard time? She has just done something wonderfully significant for me." I read that and I thought, I have to tell you that, the way it says it in the Message Bible. Because what she did was not just okay, it was wonderfully significant. It has significance. See, sacrifice doesn't always make sense, but as Christ followers, we have to know that when we are sacrificing in the name of Jesus, it's not just okay. It's wonderfully significant. It has powerful meaning. It's life-changing. Here's the truth. A person who doesn't have a spiritual way of thinking, they will never get it. They'll never understand. Have you ever talked to somebody about what God is doing in your life, and they're looking at you like, yeah, right. Have you ever had that? You know how to... Isn't that frustrating? Isn't that a little frustrating? Don't you just want to shake them and go, you better get this. Because this is true. This has spiritual meaning to it. God wants us to give significantly in our lives, wonderfully significantly to others, because he wants to use us to reach them for him. Because through that, you will not only change their lives here on earth, but change it for eternity. You and I are called to be life changers. We, each one of us, are called to do that. See, she came, this woman, came to Jesus, and she didn't just give him a little bit of something. She gave him her best. She gave him her best. Well, people didn't get that around her. But sometimes I relate that to people in the room, that sometimes what happens is that you and I give our best and people don't get that. They honestly, they think you're all a little over the top. You're kind of, you guys don't know this, but you're kind of fanatical. Yeah. Praise the Lord. Watched a football game last week. I know it was on because Bill called and razzed me about it. And so I was watching this game, and here's this guy at a football game, and it's like 0 degrees, or I don't know, Scott, what was it, 10 degrees below zero. It was ridiculous. And here's this guy with no shirt on screaming for his football team. And I'm going, why is that okay? But when you and I are at dinner at a restaurant and we stop to pray, people look at you kind of crazy. I hate to tell you this, but we ain't the crazy ones. Right? You know, it's so amazing to me how we look at things differently when we don't know the truth. And God is calling us to speak the truth into a dark world. You and I, as Christ followers, we need to love the house. We need to love each other. We need to love God. We need to love these people who are in darkness. And we need to love them to Jesus. Yeah, but Andy, you don't understand. I've got to pay my taxes this week. I stopped at the gas pump, and you know how much it cost me to fill up my tank? $70. And you want me to be a person who gives of myself. And that, I know what you mean, Andy, because you're a pastor. You want me to put some money in the collection plate. But listen, I'm paying my taxes. I'm paying these gas prices. Have you gone shopping for groceries lately? I went shopping for groceries the other day. And you know what? I walked out with 3 bags of groceries and $60 less in my pocket. How does that happen? Do you know what I'm saying? Friends, we see that and we go, what are we supposed to do? People say, what are we supposed to do? And you say, God is my source. God is the one who provides. You know, in my life, when I first started giving of myself in all different areas of my life, part of it was giving financially to the Lord. And, you know, when I met Shirley, remember that story? I had bought her a ring, and it was a diamond speck ring. Have you ever heard of a diamond speck ring? I was making a fortune. I was working, just started out in business. I was making $12,000 a year. I was just over the poverty level. I just barely could make it. And I went to the store. I went to a jewelry store and bought it. It had a warranty on it that they would make sure that the diamond speck stayed in there. And so I give Shirley this ring, and she looks at it. And then a few years later, we were doing a little bit better. And I said, give me that ring because I want to go and do something with it. And I gave her the ring. I took the ring, and I put a little bigger speck diamond in it. And I gave it back to her. And then a few years later, I said, hey, let me have your ring. I have to go bring it to the store to have them check it out because I wanted to give her like a real wedding ring. And she goes, you know what she said? Don't touch my wedding ring. I want that wedding ring just the way it is. I don't want a bigger diamond. I don't want a bigger anything because this ring. Sorry. Came with love. The ring came with love. See, friends, listen. Here's the story. Sorry. We all have these things that hit us. We have stuff that happens in our lives. And God says, act in love. That we're called to be people who sacrifice what we have for others, to care for one another, to help one another, to love one another. Here's a point for your notes. Write it down because I didn't put any points in your notes this week. Here's what it says. Every time your heart will try to have faith, your mind will try to make sense. And people will say, how do you make sense of this? How do you want to do this? And because that's what happens. Our minds try to reason things away when you and I step out in faith. You know, there are people today who are listening to this message and you're getting ready for a surgery. Maybe you're getting ready for a surgery. And the doctors say, well, we'll have to see what happens. We don't know what's going to happen. And I'll tell you this, God knows what's going to happen. And so when we walk through this, I'm not telling you you're going to be the Rock of Gibraltar and don't be concerned about stuff that happens. But the reality of it is this. No matter what happens, God is going to see us through whatever it is we're dealing with. He's going to. And so we have to walk that way. You see, people want to deflect into different areas. And so maybe you're talking about how you want to give of yourself to different things. And people say, well, the economy isn't good. Can I tell you something? I know quite a few rich people. I know some rich people. Let me tell you what rich people say. When the economy's good, I get rich. And when the economy's bad, I get richer. You see, when God's economy is good, we're rich. We're blessed. When it's bad, He gives us an opportunity to share God with others and be richer. Reach more people. Touch more lives. If that didn't make sense to you, see me afterwards. I'll give you an idea of what I'm talking about. It's not about getting rich. It's about saying that no matter what the situation is, no matter what we're dealing with, God is bigger. And we have to walk in that. Sacrifice. Here's the definition of sacrifice. I put this in your notes. I think I did. Sacrifice equals the act of giving up something of value for the sake of something else regarded as more important. The Apostle Paul tells us about this type of response. He tells us in Romans 12:1. My eyes are a mess now because of that. Sorry, guys. Romans 12:1. Here's what it says. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. The word body in Greek is more than the physical body. We read that and think, well, he's telling us to live healthy lives, and that's part of it. But what it really means, he wants all of us to live a healthy life. He wants us physically and spiritually and mentally to live full lives, complete. God's mercy is upon us. I'm glad for that. I'm so glad for that. So here's this woman. She's pouring out her future, everything that she has, on this Jesus guy. And what would cause her to do this? Why would she do this? You and I would sacrifice, you know, for someone who's done something for us. Who was this woman anyway? Turn to John chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. Mary. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Here, a dinner was given in Jesus' honor. Martha served, while Lazarus was among those reclining at the table with him. Then, who is that? Then Mary took about the pint of pure nard, the expensive perfume. She poured it on Jesus' feet, wiped his feet with her hair, and the house was full of fragrance of the perfume. You see, this woman who sacrificed her future for Jesus was Lazarus' sister. He healed. He brought her brother back to life. Hey, listen, when someone brings your brother back to life, you'll sacrifice for them. They bring your family back to life. They bring your spouse back to life. They bring your... If someone did that, there's no doubt that you would do that. We would do that. Jesus did that for you and me. And we were sinners still. You see, that's what brings us to where we are. See, Jesus has transformed our lives. He's transformed us. He's changed us from Andy the leper to Andy the blessed, to Andy the bad guy, to Andy the guy that's seeking God with all of his life, all of his heart. And same thing with your name in those places. You see, have you experienced God's mercy in your life, in your own life? If I took a microphone and went around this room, all of you can tell about God's mercy on your life. Every one of you would have a different story. I mean, have you experienced God's faithfulness in your life? And if you say yes, did you deserve it at the time? I've experienced God's faithfulness in my life. And this was one time when I didn't get what I had coming to me. Thank you, Jesus. Right? We've all been there. We all know what that is. Have you ever messed up in your life? And every time God forgives you, every time, the God of second chances, I talked about that last week, and the reality is, he's not the God of second chances like he did with Jonah. He's the God of second, third, fourth, 50 chances. He will work in our lives. You can't walk out of the love of God in your life. You and I are so blessed. How do you respond when you and I serve a God who sacrificed his life for us when we didn't deserve it? What's our response? What are we going to do? We have to sacrifice for God and one another the same. See, there's a saying out there that farmers have. A farmer doesn't give a funeral for a seed he puts in the ground. Never. Because that seed that he puts in the ground, if he's putting it in good soil, grows. It grows. It doesn't get choked out. When you and I share our hearts with people, when we help people, it's not wasted. It's not something you could have been doing. Because here's what you're doing. You're teaching people about Jesus through your own actions and what you do in life. I always say this, and I've said it for years and years. God wants our time. He wants our talents. And he wants our treasures. Today, you might be hearing this message, and you go, well, I really don't have a whole lot of time. Well, yes, you do. I really don't have a lot of talent. Well, you have more talent than you think you do. Well, but my treasures, I barely make it. And God says, just trust me in this. Give of yourself fully to God and let him do the rest. And I guarantee you this. Today's message, believe me, is not about giving. It's about giving to one another. It's about giving to God. It's about us walking in the way God wants us Here's the deal. Those of you who are watching today, maybe you're having trouble in your marriage today. And here's what I say to that. If you learn how to have a relationship with God together, you'll learn how to have a relationship with each other together. It has to be that way. If you're having issues with finances, if you're having issues with emotions, if you're having issues with depression and discouragement, if you're dealing with alcoholism or drug issues, the only way you're going to be able to live the life God has for you is if you put God in your life, in the middle, in the center of everything that you're doing. It has to be about that. How am I doing on time, okay? 7 minutes. I lied when I said this was going to be a shorter message. So here we go. I just want to leave you with a story. 7 minutes left. My mentor, a guy who was a mentor to me, had a 15-year-old son and a 12-year-old daughter. He was a young man, very successful businessman, Christ follower, chairman of the elders. And I met him, and he took me under his wing, if you know what I'm saying. He wanted to teach me. He spent time with me. His name was Kirk. Well, one day Kirk found out he's got terminal cancer. He's got 6 months to live. And Kirk says, well, I have terminal cancer, Andy. And they tell me I have 6 months to live. And so what do you say to that? I'm sorry. I'm very sorry. He says, well, don't be sorry, because my son is 15 years old and he graduates when he's 18 and I'm going to see him graduate. I said, but Kurt, you know what the doctor said. He says, I know what the doctor says, but I've read what Jesus says on his son's graduation. He was there, and he saw his son graduate. I talked to him after that, and I'm astonished, because he had 6 months to live, and now it's 3 years later, and his son just graduated from school. I said, well, you made it. You made it, buddy. You know, congratulations. He goes, well, he goes, I got to tell you something. And I go, what's that? He says, my daughter, she's 15. And he says, I'm going to walk her down the aisle when she gets married. And I looked at him and I said, Kurt, you know, this is really great that your son graduated from high school and you got to see it. But, you know, remember what the doctor said. He says, I remember what the doctor said, but I read what Jesus said. So now his daughter is 19 years old. And she's getting married at 19 years old. And here's Kurt at 19, her daughter's at 19 years old. And he's walking her down the aisle. He, at this point, he has a walker. He can barely get around. And he walked her down the aisle, and it was a long aisle. And he didn't have a walker. He didn't have a cane. He had his daughter under his arm. And he walked down. And he got to the end, and he saw his daughter get married. And I said, you're a miracle. I saw that. I said, you're a miracle. And he goes, God is the miracle-working God.
And he goes, Andy, now I'm ready. What I wanted to have happen, God gave me the grace to be able to live through that, to see that. And within 6 months, he passed away. You see, friends, here's what I'm saying to you today. That I don't know if I can even say it. God wants us to put him first in our lives. He wants us to be willing to sacrifice for him because he sacrificed for us. His goodness and mercy will follow us every day of our lives. And so we just have to, when we see those moments in our lives, when the report is bad, we have to lean in to God who is good all the time. Amen? Maybe you're watching today. Maybe you've never asked Jesus to be the Lord of your life. I want you to know today that I feel this in my heart, that there are people who are watching, maybe here, maybe far away, that need to say, Lord, come into my life. I need to make a change, and I need to do it now. Do it now. Please do it now. We don't know what tomorrow holds, but we know who holds our tomorrow. Follow me. Pray after me. If you'd like to make Jesus the Lord of your life, let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, come into my life. Forgive me of my sins. I repent of my sins. I accept you now as my personal Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. If you pray that for the first time, your life will never be the same. Seek him out. Find a church where you live that believes in the fullness of God and go there. Continue to watch us. If you need prayer this morning, please go to the back. Ron and Robert, if you'll pray with people back there, and then we'll close our service together. Thanks for being here today. He's higher than any other. Who could stand against the power of God? No one. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day, for this time together. Lord, hopefully we walk out of here today, whoever's watching all over the world, that you walk out of that place full of fire for God, because our God, who lives within us, is greater and stronger than any troubles that are going to come your way. Walk in that power. Be a person who sacrifices for God in every step that you take. And I guarantee you this, your life will never, ever be the same. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said,
Amen.
Thanks for being here.